When I finished university back in 2012, I was so excited to be hired as a copywriter working in a small town outside Toronto. At the time, I had $24,000 in student loans, and even though my salary wasn't high, I was determined to pay that debt down as fast as possible. So I rented out a bedroom in a home that was roughly the size of this rectangle, and I got this space for a cost of just $450 per month. Again, this was a small town. For extra cash, I took a weekend job working as a line cook, which mostly involved getting yelled at by the head chef as I wasn't very good and he was kind of a dick. Even though I only lasted 6 months in this restaurant, during that time I paid back over $10,000 in student loans, even before I was required to make just one payment, which was great. I had proven to myself how financially responsible I was when things were tight, so I could be sure those habits would carry forward once all my loans were paid off, and I eventually got a job that paid better than my, you know, first job out of college. Jump forward 4 years to that exact scenario. I'd gotten a job through a local film union, making three times my original salary. I was free of all my student debts, and unfortunately, all of my good financial habits were gone with them. My problem was, once I'd reached my first goal, I didn't have a follow-up for making investments and saving for the future. So recently I sat down with Alphil, the co-founder of the Financial Literacy Council, to talk about some of the mistakes I made in my late 20s that hopefully some of you will be able to avoid, and what all of us can do to start taking control of our own financial habits.
What are some of the biggest mistakes you see people making when it comes to money?
Yeah, so when it comes to money and financial decisions, the mistakes that I see people often make are two. The first one is they buy more cash pigs than they do cash cows. And so cash pigs are purchases that we make. We enjoy it for the moment. After we buy, it's not worth anything. And cash cows, on the other hand, are purchases that we make that have the potential to make us money. In terms of passive income. So that's when we buy assets or we invest in our education or we invest in stocks. You want to have more cash cows than cash pigs. And then the second mistake I see people make when it comes to money is they don't start investing early. So they don't take advantage of time being on their side through compound interest. You can get started. There are some investment programs that you can start as low as $50 a month, and you would practice something called dollar cost averaging, where you would buy an investment over a period of time at regular intervals. So you would do it on a monthly basis. And what that will do in effect is it will protect you from the risk of volatility, so the market's going up and down.
What would be your advice for someone who's starting out? They've gotten their first job, maybe their second job, they're in their 20s or 30s. What are the decisions they should be making that are gonna put themselves on a financially stable path for the years that are coming down the road?
Three things you can do. The first one is to do a financial pulse check, I call it. So there is a baseline that you would use. Think of it as a rule of thumb called the 50-30-20 rule. So basically aligning your spending based on 50% for your needs, 30% for your wants, and 20% towards your goals. So if you're making $4,000 a month after taxes, $2,000 would go towards your needs, so the things you cannot live without. 30%, so $1,200 will go towards things that you want that you don't necessarily need to survive. And then the rest would be the 20%. Would be towards contributing towards your RRSPs, your tax-free savings accounts, or you want to put more towards paying off your debt.
Do we know how close most people get to doing that, especially in a city like this where rent winds up eating such a big part of people's income?
Yeah, so in the context that we're in Vancouver, I typically see people are spending 70 to 75% on their needs, and then the rest, of course, is they're either living on a line of credit, so they'll have a line of credit to help support them, or perhaps they need to, you know, borrow money from somewhere to make it work, or they are putting things on a credit card and it gets harder and harder to get out of that.
What are some of the first steps that people should be taking in terms of getting control of a budget and things like that? Maybe building 5-year, 10-year plans. What would be, can you walk us through some of like the questions that person should be asking if they're 24 and just kind of getting at things?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So first of all, you need to write down your 5 and 10 year goals. That's important. So whether you use a mind map where you put your name in the middle of a page and then you put, you know, circles around, okay, these are my personal goals, my career goals, my vacation goals and whatnot. It's important to just write down what you want to actualize. The next step is to put a price tag on that. And then it's important for you to sit down with someone that can help you chart a path from where you are today and what your resources are today, as well as where you are going to be in the future. Next, I would recommend that you research the income potential in your whatever chosen field that you're going into, in terms of what can you expect to earn this year, 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, if you go on that path. And that will give you a sense of, okay, well, here's what I can be working with, simply because knowledge and knowing is half the battle, especially when it comes to reaching your life goals. And of course, those life goals have at times a price tag associated with them. And so you just want to make sure, you know what, how much money will I be making over those next few years?
Even if you're not interested in trying to go all in playing the stock market or buying property, there are plenty of good reasons why that might not be the right choice for you. It's still important to look at your financial options outside of a simple salary and saving mindset. When I was 25, I saw all my earning potential through the lens of how much I was willing to work. And not only does this put a ceiling over what you can make, it also just is not a healthy way to live with a mindset solely around working more to make more. Since chatting with Alphil, I've begun looking into taking some of the money that's in my savings and investing that into index funds, which basically diversifies your investment across a number of companies. So you're not tied to the rise and fall of a single corporation. And if that's still not something you think would be right for you, well, there's always the option of taking something you're already passionate about, working hard, carving out a niche, and trying to turn that passion into a side hustle.
Oh, hey, welcome to my OnlyFans. Today, I'm gonna be doing bicep curls while talking about my favorite sensual cinema. This is your In the Mood for Love and Desert Hearts. Tune in next week when I do a shoulder workout while talking about the work of Canadian auteur David Cronenberg. Thanks so much for watching.
Don't know why I haven't made any money yet.